الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له يقول الحق وهو يهدي السبيل وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمد صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه والتابعين لهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. I apologize, last week I was unable to come because I totally lost my voice. So I even thought just coming just to show you guys that I was unable to speak. But I find it very important that this series, they carry on and we do not stop it. Inshallah ta'ala. And I hope Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He gives me a long righteous life, inshallah ta'ala. Inshallah ta'ala, today we're going to speak about the second reflection. Today we're going to reflect over al-mawtu, death. Death is bawabatul barzakh. Death is the transition moment from this world to the hereafter. It's when your body loses its soul and you're no longer able to move, speak, respond. Every limbs on your body is still in place. Your eyes are still there. Your ears are there. Your fingers, your nose, your mouth. But you can't move. Death is not the ultimate goal. In other words, death is that transition where you just move from this darul dunya to darul barzakh. But there is something after death. وَلِذَلِكَ Umar ibn Abdul Aziz rahimahullah, he said, إِنَّمَا خُلِقْتُمْ لِلْأَبَدِ. You guys were created for eternity. وَلَكِنَّكُمْ but تُنْقَلُونَ مِنْ دَارٍ إِلَى دَارٍ. You will be taken from one dar, which is dar al-dunya, to then dar al-barzakh. So even if you do die, it's because you're being taken from the darul dunya to darul barzakh. And that this is not the final ending. No, there is something after that. And that moment after it, which is darul akhirah, is going to be forever. Abu al-Ala al-Ma'arri rahimahullah, he said, in his line of poetry, خُلِقَ النَّاسُ لِلْبَقَاءِ, that the people were created to remain forever. فَضَلَّتْ أُمَّةٌ, a group of people became misguided from this. يَحْسِبُونَهُمْ لِلنَّفَادِ, when they saw death, they thought, okay, that's it. We're going to perish and we're going to go and we're never going to come back again. And that's it. So they became misguided. But what we were created for was what? To carry on. إِنَّمَا يُنْقَلُونَ مِنْ دَارِ أَعْمَالٍ, you're being taken from the دار الدنيا, which is a place you're going to come with actions. إِلَى دَارِ شَقْوَةٍ أَوْ رَشَادِ, or you're going to be taken to the hereafter where you're either going to be from the habitants of Jannah or those who reside in the hellfire. So that's the haqiqatul maut. Maut is nothing except intiqal min darin ila darin, moving from one dar to another dar. That's the reality of it. And so people don't like death. It's something that they dislike. As the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he told us in the Hadith al-Qudsi that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يَكْرَهُ الْمَوْتَ, my slave, he hates death. وَأَنَا أَكْرَهُ مَسَاءَتَهُ, and I, Allah, hate to disappoint him. My slave, he hates death. Jazakallahu khairan. My slave, he hates death. And I, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I hate to disappoint him. I hate to hurt him. Tabarani narrated in another riwayah, min hadith Anas ibn Malik, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَلَا بُدَّ لَهُ, but he has to go through this pain of death. I hate it for him, but the qadr is written that he has to go through death. He can't be taken away from it. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly tells us there that we hate death. But the question is, why is it that we hate death? Now why is it that we're not pleased with dying? The reason is because this dar we've worked in. We worked hard for this world and we're living in today. We put money in. We educated ourselves. We got a degree. We got married. We have children. So we've worked very hard for this dunya. But we haven't worked hard for the hereafter. إِنَّكُمْ عَمَّرْتُمْ دُنْيَاكُمْ. You guys have fully worked hard in your dunya. وَخَرَّبْتُمْ آخِرَتَكُمْ. And you destroyed your hereafter. So you don't want to move from a place where you've put hard work in. You've put everything you had, your money, your time, your effort, and you don't want to go to a place where you've got nothing waiting for you. You've not worked towards it. And one of the reasons why we also don't like death is because death is what changes our appearance, the way we look. This face that we have, that when we wake up in the morning, we wash our face, we put cream on, we cut our hair, we make sure we look sharp, we shower ourselves, we make sure we look beautiful, handsome. But what death does to you is it takes that away from you. You no longer look like that. Your beauty goes, your body parts get eaten by the earth. Al-Imam Hafidh Abdul Haq al-Ishbili rahimahullah has a kitab called Al-Aqibatu fi Ahwal al-Akhirah, a powerful book, where he speaks about the outcome of the affairs of the hereafter. He mentions a very powerful incident where Ali ibn Abi Talib أُوْثِيَ بِإِنَاءِ مَاءٍ. A cup of water was brought to him. لِيَشَّرَبَ مِنْهُ. So he can drink from it. فَأَخَذَ وَنَظَرَ إِلَيْهِ. Ali looked at the cup that was given to him and he looked at it from the sides. And he observed the cup. And then he said to the cup, اللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ. Allah knows best. Ali said this. كَمْ فِيكَ. How much is in you مِنْ عَيْنٍ كَحِيلٍ وَخَدٍ أَسِيلٍ. An eye of a person who placed kuhul on their eyes, and a cheek that was looked after and it was creamed. Are you made of, O cup? When we die, this earth swallows us. As Allah says in the Quran, قَدْ عَلِمْنَا مَا تَنْقُصُ الْأَرْضُ. Allah says, we know that which this earth swallows. This earth, when we get buried and we get put in our graves, the earth will swallow us. And when it swallows us, it's this earth then that people would make houses from it. And they will make utensils, cups, spoons. And the spoon and the cup is a person's body that perished, that went. So Ali is saying to this cup, you're made of a person's eye. And a person's cheek that they used to work on and make sure they look beautiful and protect their body parts. So when we think of that, we start to hate death. So that's what death does to you, is the haqa'iq and the reality of it. Yazid ibn Aban al-Raqashi, who is a student of Anas ibn Malik, he said, Ya ma'shar al-nas, O people, ألا تبكون. Why don't you guys cry? وتنوحون على أنفسكم. And you weep and wail over yourselves. Why don't you cry over yourselves? باقي حياتكم. As long as you live. Why don't you cry? Because you are a person. من الموت موعده. Who is the one death is his final abode? I mean, oh, he's going to, death has been promised for him. Who is it from? Every one of us. والقبر بيته. And the grave is his house. والثرى فراشه. And the earth is his bed that he's going to lie on. وَالدُّودُ أَنِيسُ. And the insects are going to be his companions and his friends. وَهُوَ مَعَ هَذَا. And with all of that, يَنْتَذِرُ الْفَزْعِ الْأَكْبَرِ. He's going to wait for the final fearful moment, which is the hereafter. ثُمَّ لَا يَعْرِفُ. And then you don't know where you're going to be. إِلَى الْجَنَّةِ أَوْ إِلَى النَّارِ أَوْ to the hellfire. Why shouldn't you cry if that's going to be your case? That death is your promise. Your promise death. And you're also promised that the qabr is going to be your what? Your house. This today, no one would ever put you on the floor. You don't want your face to touch the floor. You see, you dust going on you, you don't want it. But that's where you're going to finally be. You're going to lie down in that dust. The earth is going to swallow you. Your family are going to leave you there. Now you're sleeping on a nice mattress. You handpick the mattress. That day there is no mattress, it's the earth. Now you're living in a nice apartment, you make sure the lights are good, mashallah, the house is glassed and whatnot. That day is your qabr. Now you make sure you hang around with rich people, people got money, people who, you know, that day the insects are your friends. And they're the ones that are around you. All they're waiting for is to just nibble through your body and eat it. And all of that is just a transition moment for a bigger time, which is the hereafter that awaits you. And you're unaware. You don't know whether you're going to go Jannah or Nar. You're unaware of it. Then why shouldn't you not cry? وَلِذَلِكَ he then used to turn to himself, Yazid al-Raqashi, rahimahullah, and he would say to himself, وَيْحَكَ يَا يَزِيد, destruction be on you, O Yazid. مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يُصَلِّ عَنْكَ, who is going to pray on your behalf? Look what he misses. He's asking himself, once you die, who's going to pray for you? No one. You're dead now, you're not going to pray anymore. مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يَصُومُ عَنْكَ, who's going to fast on your behalf? You're going to lose that opportunity. مَنْ ذَا الَّذِي يُرْضِي عَنْكَ, who's going to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to be pleased with you? بعد الموت, after death comes to you. We might today not like death because we haven't prepared for the hereafter. But the pious predecessors, when they cried because of death, it was because they knew they were going to miss things that they used to do, the righteous deeds. Some of them would be said to them, why are you crying for? You're a righteous man, you've done good, you've worked hard. And they used to say, I'm crying because of the thirst I used to endure when I was in this world, fasting for the sake of Allah, the heat hitting my head and my mouth becoming dry. I'm going to miss that. And I'm also going to miss the night prayer where I would get out of my mattress, leave it, walk away from it, and I would pray. And one of them, he said, he used to place a stick next to himself, and whenever his legs would lose its ability, it's unable to work, move, and he finishes his prayer, he would take the stick and he would hit his legs, and he would say to his legs, قم, stand up, pray. Do you not want to compete with the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Do you not want to be like, do you not want to compete with Abu Bakr and Umar? That's how they were. Maymun ibn Mihran, as Al-Imam Dhahabi mentions in his Sirah Alam al-Nubala, he said, لَقَدْ أَدْرَكْتُ مَنْ كُنْتُ أَسْتَحِي أَنْ أَتَكَلَّمُ عِنْدَهُ. Maymun ibn Mihran, he said, I met a group of people who I used to be shy in speaking in front of them. And Maymun ibn Mihran, he was a writer for Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He was a writer, he used to write for Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. And Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, كَانَ لَا يُقَرِّبُ إِلَّا الْأَفَاضِلِ. No one could get close to Umar ibn Abdul Aziz unless he was righteous. Because he was a righteous man. He only wanted righteous people around him. So Maymun ibn Mihran, he said, لَقَدْ كُنْتُ لَقَدْ أَدْرَكْتُ, I reached a group of people who I was shy to speak in their presence. وَقَدْ أَدْرَكْتُ, and I have met, مَنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ يَتَكَلَّمُ إِلَّا بِحَقٍ أَوْ يَسْكُتْ, who will not speak except the truth. If they spoke and they opened their mouth, they would say the truth. They will speak words of good. And if they were silent, they were silent because it was good for them to be silent. وَأَدْرَكْتُ, and I reached, مَنْ لَمْ يَكُنْ يَمْلَأُ عَيْنَيْهِ, a person, I met a group of people who would not fill their eyes, meaning they will not fully look at the sky. مِنَ السَّمَاءِ, they will not look at the sama, خَوْفًا مِنْ رَبِّهِ, fear of his Lord. If they look up, they would cry. So they would bring their eyes down quickly. I met a people who were like that. Ibn Sammak rahimahullah, he said, إِنَّ الْمَوْتَى, those who are dead, لَمْ يَبْكُوا, they didn't cry. Because of what? مِنَ الْمَوْتِ, because of death. Those who died, who are in their graves, they did not cry because of the death that they went through. No. وَلَكِنَّهُمْ بَتْ يَبْكُونَ مِنْ خَسْرَةِ الْفَوْتِ They are crying because of the opportunities that came their way and they didn't benefit from. The chances that they got, the righteous deeds they could have accumulated, that missed them, that came to their minds and they cried because of missing it. Wallahi, by Allah, he said, Darun, these people have moved to a place, لَمْ يَتَزَوَّدُوا مِنْهَا They've left the dunya which they haven't taken provision from. وَدَخَلُوا And they entered Daran, a different place, لَمْ يَتَزَوَّدُوا لَهَا Which they have no provision for. If you were traveling today to a country and you did not take with you the right provision for that journey, when you opened your bag, you found you had sticks and you had rocks, you have food in it, and you're in the middle of the desert, you need water, it's painful. Because you right now need water to drink, you need food to eat, but you don't have it in your bag. The person who hasn't accumulated righteous deeds, when he comes the day of judgment, or he comes to his grave, he has come to a place where he hasn't got what was needed. He's going to cry now, he's going to feel like he wants to go back, and he wants to do righteous deeds. Muhammad ibn Sirin used to say, إِذَا ذُكِرَ عِنْدَهُ الْمَوْتِ It was said about Muhammad ibn Sirin, is if death was mentioned next to Muhammad ibn Sirin. Muhammad ibn Sirin is a tabi'i. If death was mentioned next to him, مَاتَ كُلُّ عُضْوٍ Every body part of his will die. عَلَى حِدَّتِ Individually, his body parts will just become loose. Muhammad ibn Sirin. وَقَالَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ التَّيْمِيُّ Ibrahim al-Taymi said, شَيْئَانِ Two things. قَطَعَ عَنِّي لَذَّةَ الدُّنْيَا Two things have taken away from me feeling the sweetness of this dunya. Because of these two things, I don't taste, when I eat, I don't taste food. When I sleep, I can't sleep. I don't enjoy sleeping. ذِكْرُ الْمَوْتِ When I think of death. وَذِكْرُ الْوُقُوفِ بَيْنَ يَدَيِ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلَّ And when I think of the day I'm going to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, those two things, they take away from me لَذَّةِ الدُّنْيَا The sweetness of this dunya. The reason is because standing in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only place يَوْمَ تُبْلَ السَّرَائِرِ That the secrets that are deep in your heart, the reality that no one else knew except Allah, it will be brought out in the open. There's no more secrets anymore. Everything out is in the open. And death, ya ikhwah, is the awwalu manzil, is the first stage from the stages of the hereafter. Salamat ibn Dinarin used to say, Inna khayra khaslatin, the best characteristics. أو أفضل خصلة or from one of the greatest characteristics is تكون في الإنسان for it to be in a person. One of the best characteristics to have and the best attribute to have is أن يكون أشد الناس خوفا that you are the most fearful person على نفسه on yourself. You fear for yourself. وأرجاه لكل مسلم and you have hope for every Muslim other than yourself. It's the best characteristic to ever have. That you think you have hope for everybody else, but not for yourself. You fear for yourself. You know why? Because you know yourself more than anybody else. You know yourself more than anybody else knows you. So you're scared. You're worried. And today we live in a time where the majority of us are given hope more than anything else. We're told to live a very happy, joyful life. That if today if you come to a Muslim individual and you remind them and you say, Akhi, this is your problems, this is your mistakes, this is errors that you might have, you need to inshallah ta'ala work on. Because we've been taught to just be positive, positivity. We don't like that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us those who see their mistakes and fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in it and hope the best for everybody around them. Bishr ibn al-Mundhir rahimahullah, He said, رَأَيْتُ الْأَوْزَاعِ I saw Imam Ahli Sham. Awza'i was what? He was the Imam of the people of Sham. He said, I saw him. كَأَنَّهُ أَعْمَى It was like Awza'i was blind. مِنَ الْخُشُوعِ Due to his khushu'. Awza'i, the excessive crying that he used to cry and the weeping that would come out of his eyes, it was as though he became what? He became blind from it. Rahimahullah rahmatan wasi'ah. Abdullah ibn Abi al-Hudayl, rahimahullah, he says, لَقَدْ شَغَلَتِ النَّارُ مَنْ يَعْقِلُ عَنْ ذِكْرِ الْجَنَّةِ He said that the hellfire, it has preoccupied the smart one in remembering the matters pertaining to Jannah. That the Salaf of the Ummah, some of them used to be asked about the description of Jannah and how Jannah is like and the inhabitants of Jannah, how they're going to enjoy themselves in Jannah. And they used to say, I've not read about the affairs of Jannah. I've not looked into the issues of Jannah. I've just made sure I don't enter the hellfire. ولذلك المعلى بن يزياد رحمه الله As Al-Imam Abdullah ibn Ahmad ibn Hanbal mentions in Kitab al-Zuhd and Ibn Asakir in Kitab al-Tariq al-Dimashq and Abu Nu'aym al-Asbahani in his Kitab Hilyat al-Awliya wa Tabaqat al-Asfiya that he was one day sitting with a group of Mutarrif ibn Abdullah al-Shikhir was one day sitting with a group of brothers of his فَقَاضُوا فِي ذِكْرِ الْجَنَّةِ So they started to speak about Jannah and how Jannah looks and the beauties of Jannah and the mashallah what Allah has prepared for the people of Jannah. فَقَالَ مُطَرِّفْ He responded by saying, لَا أَدْرِي I don't know what you guys are talking about pertaining to Jannah. مَا تَقُولُونَ I don't know what you guys are saying. حَالَ ذِكْرُ النَّارِ The affairs pertaining to the hellfire had got between بَيْنِي وَبَيْنَ الْجَنَّةِ It got between me and Jannah. So I don't think, he said, of Jannah. I think of the hellfire. Now, my beloved brothers and sisters, if death is something which is hatmul lazim, it's something we're all going to go through, and there's no way out of it, and we're going to 100% die, As Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Jibreel came down to him, and he said, "Ya Muhammad, عِشْ مَا شِئْتَ فَإِنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ Muhammad, live for as long as you want. You're one day gonna die. وَأَحْبِبْ and love مَنْ شِئْتَ love whoever you wish, from whoever you see. Remember that you're going to depart from that person one day. Death is a hatm which is lazim. Everyone's going to go through it. Everybody's going to endure it." If that's the reality, and we are, and it's funny because death is something even an atheist would agree to, right? You can have any religion you have, you can have any faith you want, you can believe what religion you want, you can even have no religion if you want. You can be an atheist, an agnostic, it doesn't matter. Every single body believes that death is going to come. Al-kayyis, al-aqil, smart one, the wallahi is the one who sees this opportunity today, this life today, this minute that he is in right now, it's an opportunity for you to think hard, to say, where is it that I want to be? Where do I want to take myself? Where do I want to head? Brothers and sisters, going against Allah's command, its consequences are not only bad in the hereafter, and you're not only going to bury it in the grave. Disobedience of Allah will also affect your worldly life. It will affect your worldly life. And you will live a painful life. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا وَنَحْشُرُهُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ أَعْمَى Those who oppose Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's book, they live a what? مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكًا They live a very hard life. The other day, I came into contact with a brother. I saw him when he was very, very young. He got into these He got into selling and buying drugs. And now his stability and his mindset and the way he thinks is all over the place. I remember many years ago, I'm talking about three years and a half ago, maybe even four, I advised him one time. I saw him with the wrong crowd. And I told him, what you're doing is not good. This path that you're treading on is not going to bring you about any good. Look at who you become friends with. These individuals that you're around, I'm sure they are not going to benefit you. So he ignored what I had to tell him, and he carried his life the way he did. The other day, I came into contact with him sitting in the middle of a road. I was driving in the middle of the road. Because of the excessive drugs that he's taken, his mind is all over the place. He's young, he's not reached 20 years of age. The disobedience of Allah, its consequences are bad here. I remember one time when I became an imam of my local masjid, I am an imam of. And the people of the locality were like, Alhamdulillah, mashallah, you've come, you're part of the masjid. But there's something that I said to them, and I truly believe this. I said, I save my religion in this masjid. I'm doing myself a favor in coming to the masjid. I'm doing myself a favor by being in the masjid. I'm not doing the community a favor, number one. By being in the masjid, by being part of the masjid, I'm number one doing myself a favor. And every single person you see go astray and go away, whether it be selling drugs, buying drugs, hanging around with the wrong people, you will always find they disconnect themselves from what? From the masjid. Watch them. You won't see them in the Jum'ah wala Jama'at. And the wolf will eat in the dhi'ba ya'kulu al-ghanam al-qasi. The wolf will only eat the goat that's alone. When he sees you, the shaitan, when he sees you by yourself alone, disconnected yourself from the ummah that you were with. Because in the masjid, all of the people who are around you are your brothers. You're safe now. You're safe in this place. It's a shield for you. When you walk away, you take a step out, you're vulnerable, you're weak, you're open to everything. Wallahi, your iman can be as high as it wants. Your deen can be as high as it wants. Your religion can be as strong as it wants. It's a matter of days. And you will see yourself go astray. And you will see yourself seeing things that you never used to see normal. You'll start to see it normal now. Brothers, wallahi, I say this from a heart that loves you all. And I truly do. And I've said this before. I grew up in North London. This is my area. أوردها سعد وسعد المشتمل ما هكذا سعد تولد الإبل. This is not how matters are done, youngsters and brothers. The way that you will live your life, the way you are right now, careless. That's not how matters are done. Wallahi, the angel of death, when it comes, it doesn't care how young you are. It doesn't care how old you are. It will come, baghta, unsuspectedly. It will take you out. Sometimes we get fooled by that, the fact that we're young. We might think to ourselves, Alhamdulillah, I'm going to live for a while. But you know what's funny? The people who die younger are more than those who die old age. You know that, right? But it's that one person who passes the age of 60 who lives on, shaitan will make us think that we're going to be that one person. One person might live after 60 and 100 might die younger than 40, 30. But we'll always look at that one that lived after 60. It's the deceptions of shaitan. Sah? Account yourself. If you know today yourself, you as an individual, if you know what you're doing and what you're up to is wrong, why do you expect Allah to enter you into paradise? To have mercy on you and to enter you Jannah? Allah is merciful, inshallah, and He will enter you Jannah, inshallah. But why do you expect it? If you yourself know. From the righteous deeds, ya ikhwah, is your parents. Every one of you has that opportunity. Your mother, your father is alive, and you have that opportunity to take their advices. A lot of us, alhamdulillah, we don't have to fight with our parents about praying and fasting and fearing Allah. They're already pushing us to it. You see, I remember a couple of days ago, I called my dad back home in Somalia. I spoke to him. My dad's now very old in age. Older than he was before, but he's still young. So he said something to me. He said to me, "Dad, I'm at an age where I just want you guys to know if I'm alive or dead. I'm just old. Just keep track of me. Every now and then, just find out, is Dad, are you with me?" So it really touched me, because he was at a day when in his life when he was young, right? He was young, a youth. It's the cycle of life. Everybody, I remember when I was young, there was things I used to feel in my heart that, you know, I hear my mom complain about, or my back, my this. Now I see myself sometimes complaining about the things and think to myself, oh, this part hurts me. And I can already see age is coming, it's coming. So death is going to come to you wherever you are. وَلَوْ كُنْتُمْ فِي بُرُوجٍ مُشَيَّدَةٍ. Even if you're in a tough wall, death will come to you and it will take you. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will only have mercy on you and will only remember you in and protect you from, if you were there in the dunya working hard, putting effort and hard work. In my local masjid, I started doing the biography of I started the explanation of the kitab Jilbab al-Mar'at al-Muslima. The book is written by who? Sheikh al-Albani. And when I was preparing, normally the scholars, what they do is they, before they explain the book, they explain the what? The author. So I went through the life of the author. And I was reading his life at the ending. When Sheikh Nasir was on his deathbed, he wrote a farewell. He wrote a wasiyah. And from the wasiyah was, and the points that he requested for it to be done for him was that he could be hastened to his grave quickly. He said, "If my family members are outside the country and they're not in where I am right now, don't waste too much time calling them and saying to them, Albani is dead, he's passed away, come." So I stood over that line, like, hasten me to my grave. A person would only say that if they worked hard. Would only want to go to his grave quickly if he's got something to run to. And he requested if he could be taken on the shoulders according to the sunnah and not by car. And if he can be taken to the closest grave. And he also requested many other conditions. Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen was told about what Sheikh Nasir had written and what he requested for. And he said something. He said, "Sheikh Albani implemented the sunnah when he was alive. And he also made sure the sunnah was followed when he passed away." Alayhi rahmatullah. And that's the reality. Today you're living this world. You're doing something. You're saying something. And that's the way you're going to most likely die. Man amila ala shay'in. Anyone who does something, most likely he's going to die doing that one thing that he used to. He's going to pass out on that. If you're a person who used to pray a lot, the chances is high that you're going to pass away praying, right? And if you were reading Quran a lot, you're most likely going to pass out, inshallah ta'ala, and die reading the Quran. But if you spent your life on the streets, walking around the streets, just, or you spent your life just in business and work and whatever, you're most likely going to die that way. It might be something good that you might die on. You might even die on something that's not haram. That's normal. Just take benefit from your time and prepare for death when it comes to you. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us those whose speech and their action and their righteous deeds is in accordance to what pleases Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anything which I have said that was wrong or incorrect is from me, a shaitan, and Allah and His Messenger are free from it. Subhanak Allahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh. These series are not meant to be long and they're not meant to be evidence here and there. It's just meant to be reflection, inshallah ta'ala.